Whereas at the moment, we're opening ourselves up to punch upon punch upon punch upon our chin, knockout blows by Muslim apologists who see an open goal at this present time. And it's going to get more and more difficult as time goes on, because as Islam grows stronger in the West, with it attacking and undermining the authority of the Bible, it will gain even more ground. So, people like Mike Lacona, Jay Smith, and James White, they defend Christianity. I mean, James White is a presuppositionalist, but they still defend Christianity with a very kind of loose defense in textual criticism, where they will admit that there are things in the Bible that shouldn't be in the Bible. So, for example, the woman who's caught in adultery, the last ending of Mark, the Trinity text in 1 John. And they're at ease with that, and they're happy with that, but that really undermines your defense of the integrity of the text.
We would never make the claim about the Bible. We don't have the original Bible. We know it's been changed.
And I think that the J. Smith, Lycona, James White way of defending the integrity of the text is very, very weak. And there needs to be a much more robust defense of the Bible. We need to return back to our confessions and turn back to what to see what the Bible says about itself, looking at it, looking at then begin to look at and write books about textual criticism from a theological point of view. We need to take back textual criticism into the domain of the church, and rather than allow secular scholars to define our methodologies and the way we approach this topic.
Our understanding of the Trinity should be that the Trinity is, found in 1 John 5, 7, where it says there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. These three are one.
1 John 5, 7, that's found in the King James Bible, says that there are three witnesses in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Spirit, and these three are one. This is a verse that was added to the Bible in 1522 when Erasmus, who was the first publisher of any Greek New Testament, got pressure from the church to add this Trinitarian statement because it had been found in some Latin manuscripts. And so there was some scribe by the name of Roy working in 1520 at Oxford, and he writes out this whole Greek New Testament. It somehow gets into Erasmus's hands, and Erasmus never made the promise that he'd put it in if he found such a manuscript, but he basically said the reverse. I didn't put it in because I didn't find any manuscript. So he finds this manuscript. I'm sure somebody brought it to his door. And he writes in that Greek text, and he actually changes the text from what Roy had written, because Roy didn't know Greek very well. He translated the Latin into Greek, and Erasmus had to make the fixes. But it's not found in our ancient manuscripts. It's found in four 16th century manuscripts and four manuscripts in the 12th century or later in the marginal note with a 16th or 17th century hand. That's a passage that I'd have to say, this is not authentic.
But they still defend Christianity with a very kind of loose defense in textual criticism, where they will admit that there are things in the Bible that shouldn't be in the Bible. So, for example, the woman who's caught in adultery, the last ending of Mark, the Trinity text in 1 John. And they're at ease with that, and they're happy with that.
What do you do when you have a text that is highly questionable, that it might be a later expansion? Well, people ask me, when you're preaching through, for example, the Gospel of John, and you encounter the pericope adulterae, the story of the woman taken in adultery in John 7:53 through 8:11, would you preach that as the Word of God? Because John 7:53 through 8:11 and Mark 16:9 through 20 are the two largest textual variants in the New Testament. There's nothing else that even comes close to those two. Everything else is just like a line, word, phrase, a verse, something like that. But those are two blocks of text.
Now, I know that there are many scholars out there who see what I'm saying is right, and I know that they're seen as fringe scholars in the academic world, but it doesn't matter. the position that I'm expounding is a right position, it's a true position, and it's a biblical position. What is needed is for more mainstream academic scholars to realize how strategic this is concerning Islam. Islam is going to advance more and more in the West, and this is going to happen if this issue is not addressed now. It needs to be addressed now.
And as Dan Wallace has put it, the story of the woman taken adultery is his favorite story that's not actually in the Bible. And he's the textual critic down at Dallas Seminary. And the reality is that there is almost no chance that that story is original to the Gospel of John. Not only is the earliest manuscript evidence for it in a Greek manuscript from the 5th century, but the thing that really makes it obvious is that in some manuscripts, it's not even in John. It's in Luke. So when you've got a block of text that's sort of looking for a place to call home, that's a really, really good indication that it's not original. So people ask, well, if you were preaching through John, would you preach John 7:53 through 8:11? But would I preach that as scripture? No, I would not. I would not. I would go to John 8:12 and pick up from there. And in the same way, if I was preaching through Luke 23, I would make sure that people understood this phrase. There's a high amount of doubt to be attached to it, because we have this information. We have all this information. We have all these manuscripts. And those little notes down at the bottom of the page, there's a reason why they're there. And you might say, well, I don't want to hear about that kind of thing. I don't like that. Folks, let me tell you something. It's extremely important.
We need a more robust defense of our side in the area of textual criticism.
But in the process, we need to recognize that there were certain texts that were marginal notes, like John 5:4 about the angel stirring the waters. They got inserted into the text, all sorts of things like that. We need to know our Bibles. We cannot stick our heads in the sand anymore.
We don't have the original Bible. We know it's been changed.